Satan, Still Under Christ's Kingdom Scrutiny, by Steve C. Varner. Published by Westbow Press and narrated by Ellie Allen. This book presents a plan to step on Satan's toes in showing the world that it is the Lord Jesus Christ, and he alone, who has the final sting of rebuke. Death brought about by Satan no longer has victory, and physical death has no sting. This is a description of who Satan and his followers really are, the ultimate cowards. It is also a personal and family study guide to understanding God's divine pattern, plan of salvation, why Christians have hope within, and how to teach our children that we are instructed to abhor that which is evil. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 54 through 55. The bodies we now have are weak and can die, but they will be changed into bodies that are eternal. Then the scriptures will come true. Death has lost the battle. Where is its victory? Where is its sting? I always wish that someone would provide me with information that I personally perceived as valuable and that would help me understand why we have so much chaos in the world. There are a lot of us who would like to understand how to be assured that we are saved. By trying different church congregations and denominations, I found that there are too many man-made creeds and traditions which are not in agreement with the Holy Scriptures. I lost trust in all these so-called religions. I finally realized through reading that there is one thing definite. I could trust God's word and his word only. When God divinely inspired the writers, there was a sound doctrine established which all of them verified in one accord. The principles presented in each book of the Bible provide all the evidence we need to understand God's plan for us. Now that we have access to the original Aramaic Syriac Peshitta, Greek and Hebrew manuscripts, and so many discovered documents, it is evident the principles for salvation handed down by divine inspiration were compiled as an all-inclusive plan and not picked and chosen at someone's discretion. God told us that as time goes on, our knowledge would increase. This writing is not intended to be taken solely upon its merit without referencing as many versions of the Holy Bible, Greek lexicons, and concordances as possible while you study. We have been instructed to seek out our own salvation with fear and trembling. I chose the King James Version of the Old and New Testament texts available to public domain. However, I always like to compare scriptures to the Aramaic Syriac Peshitta, which would have been the language Jesus spoke, most likely with Hebrew as well. Since our God is the one who divided the languages, I am sure he would know all translations. I hope this becomes a trustworthy guide to seeking the truth. Preface. Our Creator once told a cherubim angel that he was the seed of perfection, full of wisdom and perfect in beauty, that he was blameless in his ways from the day he was created. However, that angel who was on the holy mountain decided to rebel, and exaltation was his goal, desiring to be like God. Over the course of time, he acquired the names of Lucifer, our relentless opponent, malignant Diablo, the slanderer of God's own elect. He became the prince of this world and implemented the character of the sin nature of mankind. He is still called the God of this age, with his own kingdom, his own throne, and with the power to betray and terrorize. If I am to believe God's word, I must believe it is a true story. I do believe God's word as the truth. The Holy Spirit he gives all Christians is the Spirit of truth. Since his fall from grace, he has held in bondage all who are lost and have been rejected from ever seeing heaven. The Bible says that God did allow him to return and visit heaven. He was doomed for eternity, yet set free for a short time. He is angry because he was cast down from heaven like a lightning bolt, and he knows his destiny is Sheol, under an everlasting curse with all his demonic angels following him. knowing his eternal destination will be the lake of fire. He entered the heart of a follower of Jesus, a man named Judas, to betray the Son of God. The Son of God, Jesus Christ, who implemented the law of grace and did away with the law of the Old Testament, is the one who provided the way of salvation for all of mankind, the blood atonement for sin. The power that Satan once had over death was taken away in the resurrection of the Christ from the dead. That power is no longer a victory for him, and no longer has a sting for those who have committed their lives to Christ. Because Jesus is the firstborn from the dead, you and I can also be resurrected unto life, not damnation, when Christ comes again. If we do not have the strength or will to resist Satan, he will enter us and dwell, our fate thus becoming humans of disobedience. Through the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, Satan continues to propagate betrayal and will do so until the second coming of the Messiah. Since Satan is condemned, his goal is to take the world with him. He is the mastermind of terrorism. This book is about what happens when an angel falls from grace. It is Satan's final attempt to show off his power of betrayal and terrorism. You can verify all I propose with your Bible. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8. James chapter 4, verse 7. Satan is still under the scrutiny of all those who are in God's kingdom, the kingdom of Christ. God shows us his divinely inspired plan. To understand his plan, we must put the scriptures together into one big picture. He told us to never add nor take away, but to share the principles of his wonderful kindness. There is everlasting value in understanding his awesome words, and they will change our lives forever in eternity. One of the men Almighty God took up into the heavens, Enoch, has given detailed information that I would encourage all to read, even though it was not recorded in our current Bible. Genesis chapter 5, verses 21 through 24. When Enoch was 65, he had a son named Methuselah, and during the next 300 years he had more children. Enoch truly loved God, and God took him away at the age of 365. 2 Kings chapter 2, verses 10 through 12. It won't be easy, Elijah answered. It can happen only if you see me as I am being taken away. Elijah and Elisha were walking along and talking, when suddenly there appeared between them a flaming chariot pulled by fiery horses. Right away, a strong wind took Elijah up to heaven. Elisha saw this and shouted, "Israel's cavalry and chariots have taken my master away." After Elijah had gone, Elisha tore his clothes in sorrow. These are the only two people that we know of whom God took without dying. Enoch is described as a man who walked with God. Elijah was perhaps the most powerful of God's prophets in the Old Testament. There are also prophecies of Elijah's return, Malachi chapter 4, verses 5 and 6. I sometimes wonder if it was just a coincidence that Enoch was the seventh from Adam. Oh, how he chooses perfect numbers. This is just a sample of the amazing providence of God. Of a surety, those experiences had to be awesome for them. The Bible does not specifically say why God did this. Some think they were taken in preparation for a role in the end times, and that they possibly will be the two witnesses in Revelation chapter 11, verses 3 through 12. God saved Enoch and Elijah from physical death due to their great faithfulness in serving and obeying him. Whatever the case, God had his purpose, and while we don't always understand God's plans and purposes, we know that his way is perfect. Psalm chapter 18, verse 30. If you believe God's word and you want to know more details of the events that took place in Noah's time, I encourage you to read the book of Enoch, chapters 6 through 11 of section 2. The scriptures tell us that knowledge shall increase in the later days, and this is information provided from a godly man whom the Creator had faith enough in to take him without seeing corruption. I personally believe that what he has shared is justified by God himself. Foreword. While the outcome of this book will ultimately provide perseverance and victory in the heart of the faithful reader, the negative thoughts behind the principle of Satan's power of betrayal and terrorism must be brought to light in a very real and thought-provoking manner. blame must be placed where it originated, without worrying about stepping on someone's toes, especially Satan's toes. You are encouraged to scrutinize the devil and abhor all he stands for. My goal is to stand for the cause of God's most holy organization outside the body of Christ, the family, as well as those individuals who may not have a bloodline family. Combinations of scriptural evidence and psychological reasoning have been compiled in a manner that can be taught to a child. I pray that many souls may be saved on Judgment Day. By having overcome the deception of the prince of the power of the air of this world, thus hiding the multitude of our sins, James chapter 5, verse 20, we must understand why and how sin entered our world. We must know that the terror throughout the world is already defeated, and those who are victims have the power to rise and claim victory. My desire is that you will be able to clearly see a path to follow, not because I made it available, but because the character of Christ has made it available in His Word. This book is dedicated to proving we can and do have hope within us through the traumatic ramifications of life. There is joy in knowing you have hope. Satan's final attempt is to bring the world down to his level, the abyss. He is doomed and doesn't want to go there alone. Proceed with an open mind, and you will be blessed. Sow a seed and let God Almighty give the increase. Why is it valuable to read and study about Satan? Understanding where sin originated and why we struggle with it is necessary before we can see God's plan to overcome that sin nature. As you read and study the scriptures addressed here, hope for light, and you will find it. There is no fear in perfect love. God has given you a spirit of power, of love, and a sound mind. Therefore, you can deal with the truth, and the truth will set you free. You don't have to fear any longer. God's plan for salvation will be discussed in this book. That is why the Apostle Paul told us that there is a pattern of sound words handed down throughout the ages. Refer to 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 13. Jesus told John to write to the angel of the church at Pergamum that he will give them a white stone and a new name. Whatever that stone or gift is, it must be based upon our obedience to his will. Reading through the book of 2 Corinthians will help you understand the principle of God reconciling Christ back to Him, and our duty of reconciling others back to God using both fear and love. The key here is that any fear we portray must be that of reverence of God, not fright of mankind or Satan. This book addresses additional principles we sometimes don't understand and that we struggle with. We are not in bondage to any law outside the law of grace. I am obligated to keep this teaching in context with the will of God, and I will give an account of everything taught in this writing. The blood Christ shed for His people built a wall of protection against all evil forces, and nothing can penetrate that wall. We must put up the wall and stand behind it. Hopefully, you will learn to respect the followers of the kingdom and have patience with them after reading this book. This writing gives notes related to the three prayers Jesus asked prior to His arrest. He points out the importance of the Holy Spirit in a Christian's life, which is too often forgotten or completely left out of our lives. Also included is a response to the actions of the extremists in this world and their guilt, and why they have so much hatred in their hearts. It is my prayer that all those who have succumbed to the lust of the flesh be snatched away from the leaders of the reprobate. Chapter 1. Satan. Still under Christ's kingdom scrutiny. Satan does two things to those who do not believe that Jesus is the Son of God, that He was born of the Virgin Mary, He came in the flesh, that He died for the sin of the world and rose on the third day and ascended back to heaven to sit at the right hand of the Creator, the Father, and that He sent the Holy Spirit to those of us who are His true disciples, learners. 1. He blinds, creates a veil, the minds of those who do not believe. And 2, He prevents the light of the gospel of Christ, the image of God, from shining on those who do not believe. The deception Satan brings to this earth is always under the scrutiny of the body of Christ. When you study your Greek dictionary, you will find that it describes scrutiny like this. 1. A searching examination or investigation, minute inquiry. 2. Surveillance, close and continuous watching or guarding. 3. A close and searching look. To be on guard for the things that Satan tempts us with in this deception, we must learn to resist him, knowing that he is a coward. James, chapter 4, verse 7. Submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. The only way these blinded souls can break out of Satan's bondage is by Christians preaching the knowledge of God's glory as we see it in the face of the Lord Jesus. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 1 through 6. Paraphrased. Our ministry is straightforward, and it brings light out of darkness. This is a ministry of the new agreement that God, in his mercy, has given us. And nothing will detain us from spreading the good news of exceeding wonderful kindness. We use no magic or clever tricks, no dishonest manipulation of the Bible. We speak the plain truth, and so commend ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. If the gospel of Christ is veiled, the veil has to be in the minds of those who are spiritually dying. The satanic spirit of this world blinds the minds of those who do not believe and prevents the light of the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ, the image of God, from shining on them. For it is Christ Jesus the Lord whom we preach, not ourselves. We are your servants for his sake. God, who first ordered light to shine in darkness, has flooded our hearts with his light. We can now enlighten men only because we can give them knowledge of the glory of God, as we see it in the face of Jesus Christ. So, who is the spirit of this world who has blinded so many? Ephesians chapter 2, verse 2. Wherein in time past ye walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience. Revelation chapter 20, verse 2. And he laid hold on the dragon, that old serpent, which is the devil, and Satan, and bound him 1,000 years. Isaiah chapter 14, verses 12 through 15. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nations? For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation, in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. Yet thou shalt be brought down to hell, to the sides of the pit. The one who tried to exalt himself to the same position as our Creator has been defeated and is doomed to be driven into the abyss after a short time of power here on earth, to deceive and take as many souls with him into the darkness of eternity and forever away from the presence of Almighty God. He has no power over those of us who believe in the Son of God. John chapter 12, verse 31. Now is the time for judgment on this world. Now the prince of this world will be driven out. John chapter 14, verse 30. I will not say much more to you, for the prince of this world is coming. He has no hold over me. John chapter 16, verse 11. And about judgment, because the prince of this world now stands condemned. The spiritually dead are those who are carnally minded instead of spiritually minded. Romans chapter 8, verse 6. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Romans chapter 8, verse 7. Because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. Romans chapter 6, verse 11. Likewise reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. I inherited a carnal mind through the sins of Adam and Eve, but in Christ I inherit life eternal and become a new spiritual-minded person. This is called being made alive, or a rebirth. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 5. For this ye know, that no whoremonger, nor unclean person, nor covetous man, who is an idolater, have any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 22. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. Jesus Christ, the Word, became flesh, and left the glory of heaven to bring salvation unto all men in form of a man. Once he fulfilled his mission, he returned into his original glory at the right hand of Almighty God, and then he sent the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, to guide us as we live our lives in him. John chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The Word became flesh. John chapter 1, verse 14. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. Matthew chapter 1, verse 18. Now the birth of Jesus Christ was on this wise. When as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Ghost. When Jesus rose from the grave, he promised that he would send another Comforter, other than himself, to abide with us believers forever. This Comforter is our guide into all righteousness. He reminds us of what Christ told us when he was here on earth. John chapter 14, verse 16. And I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another Comforter, that he may abide with you forever. John chapter 14, verse 26. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things, and bring all things to your remembrance, whatsoever I have said unto you. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Comforter, Holy Spirit, are one in the same being. This is called the Godhead bodily. Acts chapter 17, verse 29. For as much then as we are the offspring of God, we ought not to think that the Godhead is like unto gold or silver or stone, graven by art and man's device. Romans chapter 1, verse 20. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Colossians chapter 2, verse 9. For in him, Jesus, dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. Who could keep our Savior from returning to his original glory after such exceeding wonderful kindness to redeem us back to his Father? This was his mission, to give his life for us, become the propitiation for our sins, and return to his original glory. When Christ does return the second time, he will gather his chosen together, and we will spend eternity with him. Luke chapter 24, verse 26. Ought not Christ to have suffered these things and to enter his glory? Romans chapter 3, verse 25. Whom God hath set forth to be a propitiation, sacrifice, through faith in his blood, to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past, through the forbearance of God. 1 John chapter 2, verse 2. And he is the propitiation, sacrifice, for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. 1 John chapter 4, verse 10. Herein is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us, and sent his Son to be the propitiation, sacrifice, for our sins. What will Christ do now that he has returned to his glory? John chapter 14, verse 2. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you? John chapter 11, verse 27. She saith unto him, Yea, Lord, I do believe that thou art the Christ, the Son of God, which should come into the world. It is our duty as Christians to obey the great commission given by Jesus himself. The great commission is the ministry of reconciliation. Mark chapter 16, verses 15 through 16. He said to them, Go into the entire world and preach the gospel to all creation. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved, but whoever does not believe will be condemned. God gave Christ the ministry of reconciliation to lead us back to God, and Christ gave us the same ministry. We have all the same ministry, to lead others from the error of their ways to the truth in Christ back to Almighty God. read 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 11 and 18 below. God sent his only begotten Son into the world to redeem us or buy back mankind using the blood of Christ. The blood covenant provided by Christ Jesus is the only means of being reconciled back to Almighty God. Jesus' blood was and is the final propitiation for man's sin. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 18. And all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given to us the ministry of reconciliation. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 19. To wit, that God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 11. Since then we know what it is to fear the Lord, we try to persuade others. What we are is plain to God, and I hope it is also plain to your conscience. The ministry of reconciliation. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 17. Wherefore in all things it behooved him, Christ, to be made like unto his brethren, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make reconciliation for the sins of the people. Romans chapter 6, verse 3. Know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death? Romans chapter 6, verse 4. Therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. Romans chapter 10, verse 6. But the righteousness which is of faith speaketh on the wise, say not in thine heart who shall ascend into heaven, that is, to bring Christ down from above. Romans chapter 10, verse 7. Or who shall descend into the deep? That is, to bring up Christ again from the dead. Question. Why should we remind our brothers and sisters in Christ and encourage, admonish, and exhort each other, no matter how unworthy we are? Why would God use such people as me, a sinner, as the Apostle Paul, who was a murderer, as the woman at the well, an adulteress, to bring our loved ones into remembrance of the ways of Christ? 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 17. For this cause I have sent unto you Timotheus, who is my beloved son, and faithful in the Lord, who shall bring you into remembrance of my ways which be in Christ, as I teach everywhere in every church. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 5. Casting down imaginations, and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Possible answer. Perhaps to bring us into remembrance of the ways Jesus taught, the knowledge of God, and to bring our thoughts into captivity to obey his commands. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 13. For such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. Matthew chapter 7, verse 15. Beware of false prophets, which come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravening wolves. Matthew chapter 24, verse 11. And many false prophets shall rise and shall deceive many. Matthew chapter 24, verse 24. For there shall arise false Christs and false prophets, who shall shew great signs and wonders, insomuch that, if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect. Mark chapter 13, verse 22. For false Christs and false prophets shall rise, and shall shew signs and wonders, to seduce, if it were possible, even the elect. Luke chapter 6, verse 26. Woe unto you, when all men shall speak well of you, for so did their fathers to the false prophets. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 1. But there were false prophets also among the people, even as there shall be false teachers among you, who privily shall bring in damnable heresies, even denying the Lord that bought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction. 1 John chapter 4, verse 1. Beloved, believe not every spirit, But try the spirits whether they are of God, because many false prophets are gone out into the world. This is our reasonable service, to become ministers of the gospel and renounce our past ways, confess our sins to one another and become servants to all who are blinded. Those who are not blinded by Satan's veil have the knowledge needed to also fulfill their calling. This choice to serve is ours. If we choose not to acknowledge Christ and he who claims to be, we are then classified as Antichrist, and there are many. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 1 through 6. Therefore, since through God's mercy we have this ministry, we do not lose heart. Rather, we have renounced secret and shameful ways. We do not use deception, nor do we distort the word of God. On the contrary, by setting forth the truth plainly, we commend ourselves to everyone's conscience in the sight of God. And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. The God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers, so that they cannot see the light of the gospel that displays the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For what we preach are not ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, and ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who said, "Let light shine out of the darkness," made his light shine in our hearts to give us the light of knowledge of God's glory, displayed in the face of Christ. A warning against denying Jesus, that Jesus came in the flesh. 1 John chapter 2, verse 18. Dear children, this is the last hour, and as you have heard that the Antichrist is coming, even now many Antichrists have come. This is how we know it is the last hour. 2 John chapter 1, verse 7. I say this because many deceivers, who do not acknowledge Jesus Christ as coming in the flesh, have gone out into the world. Any such person is the deceiver and the Antichrist. Chapter 2. Satan's final attempt, the power of betrayal. The personality of Satan is defined in two divinely inspired writings of Old Testament manuscripts. Satan is described as the evil one in Isaiah chapter 14, verses 12 through 15, and symbolically as the prince of Tyrus in Ezekiel chapter 28, verses 12 through 17. Both writings provide evidence of when the concept of betrayal and terrorism began during the peak of pride in Satan's spirit. Satan is referred to as the anointed cherub that covereth in Ezekiel chapter 28, verse 14. And God said in the same verse that he, God, was the one who set him so. God created the cherub, which is a good angelic being, with greater power than man. Hebrews chapter 2, verses 6 through 7. However, the cherub was not intended to be worshipped. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 5. This angel is described in Ezekiel chapter 10, verses 3 through 22. Let me shock you into reality. From the very beginning, this was the status of Satan before his great fall from grace. You ask, when did this all take place? To put this into a time frame is very difficult to do. However, I do know what the Bible says about when this happened, that Jesus the man was Jesus, the Word. As we read in the beginning, the Word was with God and was God. The New Testament shows where the Word was manifested in the flesh. The Word became flesh. We also know that Jesus saw Satan fall from heaven when he exalted himself and gave up the status of a cherubim angel. Luke chapter 10, verses 17 through 20. At that time, Jesus was the Word, not begotten yet, not in the form of a human being as he was later. Satan was cast down into the earth as a serpent on the sixth day, which is also the day that man was created. You can read that in the book of Genesis. So we know that Satan was cast down from heaven long before God implanted the seed into the Virgin Mary and brought Jesus the man, the Word, into the world. Jesus came to destroy the power Satan gained as the prince of the power of the air here on earth. Jesus came to destroy death as we know it in the physical body. Jesus came to give life and more abundantly, exceeding above and beyond we can imagine if we believe him. One of the offices of the cherub was to wait on God. This is the meaning of the anointed cherub that covereth. So, before Satan's fall from grace, he was assigned to wait upon his Creator. Some of the angels were sent forth to announce God's law. Acts chapter 7, verse 53 states that the law was received by the character of angels. To paraphrase, Hebrews chapter 2, verse 2 says, "If the message spoken by angels was a mandate, and all transgression, unforgivable sin, and blatant disobedience was given justifiable reward, how will we today escape that same judgment by ignoring the salvation plan given in the New Testament?" Luke chapter 1, verse 18. God's message was to be conveyed by both cherubim and seraphim angels. The angels were ordained to protect God's people. The story of Lot being pursued by angels in the morning, saying, "Get up and take your wife and your two daughters who are here before you are consumed in the iniquity of the city," is a good example. I encourage you to read this scenario. Genesis chapter 11, verse 27, chapter 12, verses 1 through 13, chapter 18, verses 16 through 19, and 38. The angels were ordered to inflict divine penalties on behalf of Almighty God. "Let the people be like the husk blowing in the wind, and let the angel of the Lord discipline them. Let their path be like the darkness of the abyss, and treacherous, and let the angel of Jesus be the one to persecute them." Psalms chapter 35, verses 5 through 6. 2 Samuel chapter 24, verse 16. 1 Chronicles chapter 21, verses 14 through 17. Perhaps Satan liked this power so much that he let it overwhelm him into the acts that followed. It is true even today. Once we have been given power to accomplish many things by God, we soon find ourselves wanting more power. The angels were ministering spirits. For God will place his angels in charge over you to keep you sound in the ways of judgment. They will guide your feet and keep you from kicking against the stones. Psalms chapter 91, verses 11 through 12. Hebrews chapter 1, verses 13 through 14. We can see here that the responsibilities given by God to the angels were many and diverse, to the extremes. The good angels guarded cities and even nations while sharing in the council. The New Testament writers said they would confirm that there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over any sinner willing to change. Luke chapter 15, verse 10. In recompensing the house of Israel, in chapters 9 and 10 of Ezekiel, verification is made that there indeed was life and spirit in the cherubim, as mentioned in Ezekiel chapter 10, verses 17 through 22. Out of the acts of betrayal of God's plan, when Satan entered in, came the necessity of sanctification. God was betrayed by his chosen race, Israel, and declared execution of judgment on the nation for the remaining children of that race to be sanctified. The remnant that was preserved would ultimately carry on the chosen race lineage through the Melchizedekian bloodline. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 11. "And some of you, before accepting Christ as your Savior, were carnal-minded or materialistic. But now you are washed in the blood and are sanctified and justified in the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God." God's plan now was to send the Word, a part of his triune Godhead, the Christ, to earth, in the form of man, to redeem or buy back all of those who would submit to him. He also sent the third part of his Godhead, the Holy Spirit, or Comforter, as a gift to all of those who obeyed his commandments. Therefore, God said in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, "Let us the God."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.